When you win a spelling bee or run the fastest marathon for your group, you've topped all the competition. But that doesn't mean you stop there. You probably keep going and improving, trying to beat your own record. And when it comes to the tallest mountain in the world, Everest is kind of doing the same. Throughout its history, it's grown much more than its neighbors. Everest is taller than all the other mountains, not just because it's in the Himalayas, but because of its own unique and weird circumstances pushing it higher into the sky than other Himalayan peaks. And it's not done yet. Tens of millions of years ago, a tectonic plate south of Eurasia crashed into the continent's southern border. The land at this fault line crumpled up like the hood of a car in a head-on crash, and rose more than 3 kilometers into the air. Then, around 50 million years ago, it sustained another blow when the slab of land that's now India slammed into the same spot. India could have acted like a giant shoehorn, sliding underneath the edge of the Eurasian plate and shoving the land above it even higher into the air, turning the Himalayan mountains into the tallest peaks in the world. But in the race to the top, one mountain surged past the rest, one that has gained international recognition as a giant among giants, the tallest mountain in the world. Locals call it Chomolungma or Sagarmatha, and you might know it as Everest. And even after Everest outgrew its Himalayan neighbors, it never stopped rising. Today, it towers over them by about 250 meters, and it continues to grow at around double the rate that experts expect. And we do expect Everest to be growing some, even though it might seem like there aren't any giant landmasses smashing into it anymore. Because in fact, India is still pushing into the rest of Asia. That's causing land to move in a bunch of complex ways along the fault line, including up. At the same time, ordinary weathering is wearing down the Himalayas, just like it wears down all mountains. That's erosion at work. And even though this erosion itself shaves mountains down, it also makes them taller. I know that sounds like the opposite should happen, but let me explain. The ground isn't as sturdy as it feels to you or me. It's not even really staying in one place. Earth's crust, the part that we stand on, and that Everest is made out of, is floating on top of the mantle, a layer of rock that can flow slowly, kind of like a thick layer of caramel. So the crust can move, meaning that ground level doesn't necessarily stay at ground level. One of the things that move the crust along the Carmel River mantle is weight. When the crust becomes heavier, it sinks deeper down into the mantle. And when it gets lighter, like when part of a giant mountain gets eroded away, it lifts out of the mantle more. It's just like what happened in the cinematic masterpiece Titanic. Rose was floating on the door, slightly submerged in the water. But it was slightly submerged because Jack was holding on to the door, weighing it down. Once Jack let go, Rose could float higher and live to tell the tale. The door is Mount Everest, the water is the mantle, and Jack eroded away. Which is why it didn't matter that there was enough room on the door for Jack. He was weighing it down and they both would be exposed to more cold water and freeze. The point is, Everest will float higher or lower on the mantle depending on how heavy it is. Exactly how much it sinks or rises depends on the specific geology of the area, but it can be a lot. During the last ice age, when the continents were covered in thick, heavy glaciers, parts of North America sank down hundreds of meters. And in fact, Everest is still springing back from the last ice age, which ended around 11,000 years ago. All this change takes time to unfold, because the mantle is still solid rock, so it's not like sloshing around as easily as the water under a floating door. But little by little, it keeps pushing Everest higher. And okay, it's only rising by about 2 millimeters a year these days, but over the lifetime of a mountain, even a little growth adds up. It helped make Everest the tallest mountain in the world. The problem is, even after you account for the continental impacts, ice age, and erosion, all of these effects still don't explain why Everest is rising faster than all the other Himalayan mountains around it. For that, we need to go back to Everest's early years. But before I can tell you about that, an ad.
This SciShow video is supported by Blood Moon, the sophomore album of SciShow's favorite band, Eclipsis. Is it a real band? Who's to say? But the upcoming total lunar eclipse on March 14th is very real, and their new album is a celebration of that awesome event. Not to mention the very real SciShow videos that inspired their track list. You can find those titles in the description of this video and on the back of the new Eclipsis band tee. We got the exclusive rights to sell the shirt at complexly.store/bloodmoon. Get it before the moon's gone, or just be sure to order the shirt before April 18th if you want one.
Soon after the peaks of the Himalayas reached the top of the world, they became home to glaciers. And as seasons came and went, the meltwater streaming off glaciers in the warmer months carved channels into the rock, and so Everest's rivers were born. Some rivers ran east or west, others meandered north or south, but by the time the earliest climbers were making their way up Everest, they noticed that one river wasn't quite like the others. The Arun River runs along the base of Mount Everest. It starts off flowing east, but then it abruptly cuts back and travels south, before eventually dumping into a bigger river. And rivers don't usually form in weird shapes like that. Maybe the river predated Everest, and the mountain somehow poked through the Arun River to give it this bizarre path. But researchers think that's far more peaceful than what actually happened. Coexistence with the river that was already there? Not a chance. This river is more likely to be evidence of what scientists call river piracy. Like the river itself was a pirate or the victim of piracy. One river can steal another river's water. It happens now and then when there's a shift in the way water flows over land, like after earthquakes or erosion, and it can create weird paths when it combines waterways that flow in different directions. So in a 2024 study, scientists set out to confirm if something like this ever happened to the Arun River. They used computer simulations to analyze a bunch of tributaries nearby, and sure enough, found that there was definitely something odd about the Arun. It didn't just have a weird route. Its channel was steeper than other tributaries, and the river was also more powerful. It eroded much more sediment than its neighbors. When the researchers put all these pieces together, it started to look like the Arun River really was captured by another river at some point in the past. Based on their models, they estimated that this happened 89,000 years ago, merging the flows from two rivers into one powerful river, following the bizarre path we see today. And as all the water from those two rivers churned through a single channel, it would have deepened the gorge and carried off a bunch of heavy sediment. Suddenly, land next to Mount Everest must have started getting lighter faster. Then this land would have started floating higher, like rows on the door. Now, of course, a piece of land isn't quite like a door that can just bob up and down without affecting the stuff around it, because one piece of land is connected to all the land around it. So as one spot floats higher, it tugs on the area surrounding it. In this case, the rising land around the Arun River gave Everest a pull upward. Models suggest that the loss of so much sediment over the last 89,000 years lightened Everest enough to rise dozens of meters since then. But because of the way the crust lays on top of the mantle, it wouldn't have lifted all of the Himalayas. In this case, the crust's flexibility is key. Just because it's made of rock doesn't mean it'll act like a granite countertop. For example, if you put a bowling ball under a slab of granite countertop, you'd create a slope that lifts all or most of the granite above where it was before. But if you put that same bowling ball under a mattress, sure, the middle will lift up where the ball is, but the edges of the mattress will be much closer to the ground than in the countertop example. The Earth's crust is flexible enough that the rivers had more of a mattress effect than a countertop effect, making Everest taller than its neighbors. That would make river piracy a huge missing link in Everest's story, but it still doesn't fully explain why Everest grows so fast. So we have even more discoveries to make in the future as this mystery unfolds. It's not a coincidence that Everest is the tallest mountain we have. It got its height from colliding landmasses, an ice age, pirate rivers, plain old erosion, and maybe some other factors that we still haven't discovered. At the end of the day, Everest has reached the peak of what a mountain can be on our planet. But it's not stopping there. So climbers, good luck.